Sure.
Okay. Thank you for the heads up, Allie. If any of you haven't got a chance to talk to IU, she's a great person to have a conversation with. He has lots of strong opinions and isn't afraid to voice them. And then particularly in the last few years, he's taken on a great mentoring role, and he has numerous projects that are active, his fingers in many areas. So I think it'll be fun to see the stuff he's been up to. So I'll hand it over to Ayush.
Okay, thanks, Deva. Thank you everyone for attending my thesis talk. It's a pleasure. I hope you are all doing well and staying safe. Just to mention, please feel free to drop the questions on Zoom chat. Even if I'm not able to answer during the talk, I'll answer them at the end of the talk. Let's get started. We humans are good at observing, exploring, and analyzing the world we live in. Here is Bob, who is enjoying the view of San Francisco Bay standing at the Vallejo Street. Now, Bob can move and see things happening around him. He can also imagine how the place would look with dense cloud cover on a rainy day or even at night. Bob wants to tell his beautiful experiences of this place to his friend Alice. Ideally, Bob or anyone would like to transfer this rich mental imagery to Alice. But does this happen so easily in a conversation? What happens in a standard conversation? Bob has a mental model and has an encoder that compresses this rich mental information to tiny bits consisting of words, expressions, and emotions. And Alice is trying to understand those tiny bits to see Bob's mental model as it was. This is such a lossy channel of communication. 50 years back, J.C.R. Licklider and Bob Taylor envisioned computers as a means of improving or maximizing communication between people, especially enabling communication between people from various backgrounds. Here's a sketch illustration of an interdisciplinary meeting by Roland Wilson. Shown here are different experts talking about the bridge. Example, there's a materials expert on the left, safety expert in the middle, and so on. With computers, we have now established various means of communication, such as mails, messaging, video conversation, or communication using virtual reality headsets. However, these are means of communication, trying to build a proxy of face-to-face communication by encoding words, expressions, and emotions at the source, and decoding them reliably at the destination. None of these devices allow us to have a better communication. The real promise of computing as a means to provide lossless communication is still not realized. While computers are largely used by movie producers with ample budgets to tell their stories to everyone, we have not come to a point where the technology can be used by anyone, anywhere. This is primarily due to intensive infrastructure requirement in a studio that, one, allows to densely capture the observation from multiple cameras, and consists of a team of trained artists that are experts in exploring audio and visual data, creating new content through a wide variety of tools. Now, our goal is to overcome these infrastructural challenges such that anyone can tell their stories anywhere. I introduce Computational Studio that aims to learn a representation of 4D audio visual world that can be, one, estimated from sparse real world observations, and two, can be interactively explored to create new experiences. This allows us to, one, capture four-dimensional visual world. Shown here is an example of a 4D capture where we can freeze the time and move around or stand at a point to see things happen, and so on. Now, the best results in computer graphics and machine learning have been shown using dense and perfect captures like the ones in a studio. In this work, we use sparse real-world samples. Importantly, we capture an unconstrained real world. There are no green screens. Secondly, Computational Studio allows us to explore the audio-visual data using examples. Now, in a studio, we see artists and technicians working with many knobs, but it is not so trivial for a non-expert to remember all those knobs. Examples or analogies are what we use in daily life to tell our experiences. In many cases, we cannot even describe explicitly how we imagine, but we try to tell them via examples. For example, shown here are John Oliver on left and Stephen Colbert on right. Here's an example of Stephen Colbert acting like John Oliver. Now, the big revolution in machine learning, computer vision, is owed to the labeled data that enabled supervised learning using convolutional neural networks. In this work, not only we don't have labels, but we also do not know what are the right labels or how to get them. We also go beyond the standard paradigm of training on a fixed data distribution. My work is largely built on test time training on exemplar data distributions. We begin with learning representation that enables dense 4D observation of dynamic events in the unconstrained real world. Last decade has provided each one of us with powerful cameras in our hand. Many public events are captured by multiple people from various perspectives. The world has started to look like a studio. Our goal is to utilize the data captured by different users that can allow us to synthesize a new view that was never recorded. More specifically, given n physical cameras shown by gray dots arbitrarily spread out with a minimum distance between them being 40 centimeters, our goal is to synthesize a new view seen from red dot. Now, this setup is not new. A lot of work has been done in the past 25, 30 years, primarily using a proper studio that allows camera synchronization and fixed camera baseline. The other direction is to use light field capture devices. Recent approaches have designed multi-camera rig that can be used outdoors. Closely related to our setup is the work that uses in-the-wild capture devices. These approaches are limited to a single human actor. Finally, the recent work that use in the wild multi-camera systems, but can reconstruct sparsely. In this work, we go towards unconstrained environment. The distance between cameras can be arbitrarily large, where we are not restricted by the contents of scene, and we are able to get dense 3D reconstruction and 4D visualization. Another body of work has also looked at these required scenarios. These approaches explore internet images that resulted in immersive 3D browsing, but this is primarily restricted to static scenes. Our goal is to enable immersive 4D browsing. We will first study the problem using various methods proposed in the literature and bring together the insights from each to overcome the challenges. To do this, I'm trying to position various approaches using the axes of geometry or scene structure, going from heavily utilizing it to not utilizing it. Beginning with 3D modeling, where we heavily use geometry. Now, here is a conundrum. If we use all the frames of the video, we will lose the foreground information. But if we just use this particular time instant, then we don't get dense outputs. Now, let me begin with the first, where we pose 4D visualization as a combination of 3D reconstruction of static world and human modeling for capturing the dynamics if we assume human-only events. We use CoalMap from Schonberger and colleagues and human modeling using Wu and colleagues. Shown on the left is a virtual camera view and on the right is the original camera view. Note we are using all the frames of the video for static background reconstruction. Now, we get sparse outputs, have to limit ourselves to certain types of videos, and have to live with the inherent failures of these approaches. Now, 3D reconstruction or CoalMap lose dynamic information because it has no knowledge of time. What if we restrict the reconstruction to a particular timestamp? This is also crucial because recent approaches have built on top of structure of motion or CoalMap outputs to do view synthesis. We take 13 views from one time instant and feed it to ColdMap for 3D reconstruction. Shown here is an example of reconstruction for a specific time instant using 13 views. We observe sparse outputs once again. Recent work assumes dense 3D reconstruction for a reasonable operation, which is not available here. We now look towards the insights from image-based rendering approaches. For this, I will be using the positioning from a review paper on this topic by Shuman Kang. Let me go to the other extreme on the axis, planoptic modeling. The planoptic function describes all of the image information visible from a particular viewing angle. Simply speaking, the goal is to capture every possible light ray in the scene and synthesize a new view by composing information from different light rays. The direction started with the work of Adelson and Bergen in 1991, followed by work on limiograph, light field rendering, and recent day work on NeRF or neural radiance field. We studied this direction using NeRF. Now, NeRF and other concurrent approaches have been defined mostly for static scenes. So I'm going to take views for one particular time instant. Shown here are some of the views for a time instant. There are 13 different views. We use vanilla NeRF using this data. On the left is a synthesized virtual view, and the right is the original target view. Now, NeRF is currently restricted to dense multi-views and good camera parameters, both of which are not available here. NeRF leads to noisy outputs for sparse setting and also require a new model for every time instant, which would take 2 to 3 days to synthesize a new view. We move from planoptic modeling to using explicit geometry for image-based rendering. Now think, when depth information is available for every point in one or more images, 3D warping techniques can be used to render nearby viewpoints. Shade and colleagues proposed layer depth image to store not only what is visible in the input image, but what is visible behind, what is also behind the visible surface to deal with disc occlusion artifacts. Now the idea of layer depth imaging has been revisited in the recent work on stereo magnification and local light field fusion that use multi-plane imaging. We use LLFF from Mildenhall and colleagues to study this area. Once again, LLFF has been defined for a static scene. We take 13 views from one time instant and use it with the vanilla code. Shown on the left is a synthesized virtual view using LLFF and original target view on the right. Now, clearly this is challenging. LLFF leads to blurry results partially because both Zhao and colleagues and Mildenhall and colleagues assumes perfect multiplane imaging for composition. However, multiplane imaging for sparse views are not accurate, and therefore composition leads to blurry results. Finally, we explore image-based rendering using correspondences between two views for a new view synthesis. This class is the term implicit to express the fact that geometry is not directly available. We don't care much about the depth and positioning in 3D world. 3D information is computed only using the usual projection calculations. Now, this direction has been mostly demonstrated for a two-view or stereo pair. Let me start from there. Given two views or a rectified stereo pair shown above, we estimate correspondences between them using an off-the-shelf disparity estimation module. This allows us to project pixels from the existing views to a target camera view. Now, since we have multiple views, we can actually generate multiple stereo pairs. That is, for n views, we can create n choose two stereo pairs and hence repeat the same process this many times. I'm going to show you the projection from multiple stereo pairs to the target camera view. I'm going to play for you to see how projections to target views from multiple stereo pairs look like. Some places it can be sparse, it can be dense. You see over here, different parts being captured depending on the positions of the cameras or the common things that is being contained in them. The question is, how can we fuse the information from these multiple projections to the target camera view? Now, if we take a simple per pixel median for all these multiple projections, we lose a lot of information. We observe that at a certain location shown in the red box here, there are two possibilities. One, there could be a farther background comprising of trees, or two, there could be a girl close to the camera. If we do naive average or median, we are surely going to lose the information. Now, how do we fuse information from multi-views? Chen and William suggested view-independent visible priority. However, visible priority cannot be view-independent when considering cameras with large baselines. In this work, we use the insight from Shade and colleagues on layer depth imaging. In LDI, each pixel in the input image contains a list of depth and color values with the ray from the pixel intersects with the environment. Now assume this is the space that we are interested in capturing. The frontal face of the cube is the point where we see everything happening. Let me isolate a region here. There can be something farther away as shown by the red point, or something closer as shown by green point, or even closer as shown by blue point. What would we actually see from the frontal face of the cube? We can hit a ray of light in this direction and we'll observe the closest point assuming Lambertian surfaces. We use this insight along with multi-view constraint to compose an image from multiple stereo pairs. We are able to capture the foreground information, but parts of background are still missing. We look towards the farthest point in our cube that allows us to get static background. We can further refine it by generating camera views for a given location over varying time t, that is, for a given 3D space and time axis. We can get projections for various instants of time for a fixed camera pose in 3D space. Computing a per pixel median over images for a period of time yield a static background. We combine insights from two directions. Bringing these insights together, we are able to get a foreground or things that are available for a particular instant of time and a static background averaged over time. These are complementary sources of information, but one, it does not look like a real image. And two, we don't know how to combine them analytically to make it look like a real image. Recent work have used data-driven approaches led by neural networks for synthesizing images. These usually require large pair data sets for training the model. In this work, only thing that we have are the videos captured using physical cameras and their intrinsic and extrinsic parameters. However, we can pose the problem of 4D browsing as a self-supervised composition where we can use the held out camera sequence and reconstruct it using remaining N-1 cameras. We construct a pair data for each physical camera. We get an instantaneous foreground F for camera pose C at time T, a background B for a camera pose C averaged over time, and an original image I for a camera pose C at time T. Now, this allows us to train a neural network that takes the foreground for camera pose C at time T and background for camera pose C, feeds to the foreground stream and the background stream respectively, concatenates them via a used net style architecture, and finally give the image using three con layers. We learn a function G that composes foreground for camera pose C at time T and background for camera pose C to generate a view that looks like a real image. Our optimization consists of a photometric reconstruction loss that aims to generate image close to an original image, an adversarial loss that distinguishes between a real image and a generated image for high frequencies. Using this formulation, we show a virtual camera view on the left side and contrast with the original camera view on the right. Now, contrasting our approach with and without learning a scene-specific pix-to-pix model. On the left is with learning, on the right is without learning. Let me also contrast with the nearest physical camera. On the left side is the actual camera, which was present on the left side, and On the right is a virtual view, just to contrast the difference between, just to give you a sense of how far the cameras actually are. Let me also contrast it with the camera on the right side. Now you can see in the left and right side, the illumination drastically changes, right? So there's some artifacts over here in the generated view where you will find those illumination artifacts as well. In summary, we have three essential components in our pipeline. One, estimate foreground. Two, estimate static background. Three, compose a new view using foreground and background. Simply speaking, there are three standard modules: estimating correspondences and fusing them, simple pixel operation, and a scene-specific fix-to-pix model. Bringing these insights together enabled us to overcome some restrictions posed in prior work. For example, prior work has been restricted to tight clothing and tight hair. But when you look at the actual performances, artists use flowing dresses and open hair as a means for expression. We show a virtual camera on right for a multi-view sequence for a flowing dress and open hair, and contrast it with a nearby camera on left. We also show a virtual camera generated by posing 4D visualization as 3D reconstruction and human modeling. With the flowing dress, human modeling is very challenging. We can also do more things, such as for a fixed time instant, I can move my camera virtually, freezing the time. That is, say I'm given 9 views spread out for a particular time instant. We can freeze the time and move around. We can also see behind occlusions now. Say I want to see behind the green shirt person. Let me mark the green shirt person in one frame of the video. The original video is on the left, and after removing the person on right. Now there are some ghosting artifacts, but one could say this is easy because there's nothing dynamic behind the green shirt person. The interesting bit is we also have the depth information that allows us to selectively remove things at a particular depth location. This allows to reveal even the dynamic hidden components in the scene. Say I want to see behind the red shirt person. What is it that the blue shirt guy behind the red shirt person is doing? I mark the red shirt person. Here's the original video on the left and edited video on the right, but let me show a close up for them to get a better sense. The original video is on left, and after removing occlusions is on the right. Note there are ghosting artifacts, but one can get a sense of the activity of blue shirt person on the right side. This could be possible by the use of multi-camera system. We could retrieve this information because it was captured in another view. Let me try to position different multi-view view synthesis approaches together on a 2D plot depending on their setup. Here is a plot where we have density of views on the x-axis going from dense to sparse and the quality of outputs on the y-axis. Our eventual goal is to use minimal information and yet be able to get high quality outputs. Current 3D reconstruction based approaches can utilize sparse inputs, but yields low quality sparse outputs. NRF and LLFF like approaches are currently restricted to dense views. Our approach is able to utilize sparse inputs and generate better results than 3D reconstruction. We are, however, quite far away from the goal because we are still not able to capture the fine details, such as facial details or hands of the person. And there are other artifacts in the scene which I think are really crucial to overcome. Let me also show you an objective evaluation where we can do an apples to apples comparison. On held-out camera sequence, we contrasted our approach with 3D reconstruction and human modeling. We used multiple criteria such as a mean square error, MSE, lower is better, PSNR, SSIM, higher is better, LPIPS, and FID, the distance measure, lower is better. We observed drastic difference for all of these criteria compared to 3D reconstruction and human modeling. Now, let me also present a controlled experiment to show as why I say NeRF and LLFF are currently restricted to dense multi-views. Given a multi-view sequence, we want to synthesize a new view like the one shown over here. I'm trying to synthesize this view from different amounts of views. If I use 80 views to synthesize a target view, get a reasonable output, reduce the number of views to 40, further reduce it to 10. We observe the performance degrades as we make it sparse. We observe similar trends for LLFF. These analyses also suggest the need for evaluation on unconstrained real-world samples, which are usually sparse in nature. One last thing before we move away from this part, we are also able to do dense 3D reconstruction here. Firstly, I'm showing the results of 3D reconstruction using 10 views from standard cold map. We observe sparse outputs. On the other hand, we can get dense 3D reconstruction from 10 views. Now, this is an off-the-shelf method that does not require any scene or time-specific operation, showing 3D reconstruction using MeshLab. We arbitrarily move around to see from different perspectives. Now, it is not perfect. If we see the local details around the hands of the performer or around the face, there are some imperfections over there. There are some arbitrarily floating 3D points as well. Let me end this part with discussion on the important limitations. There are many limitations in this work. Production quality. You could see that we miss a lot of information on the face and hands. In a human event, faces are very important, yet we are missing that information there. I think exploring better representation and constraints from modeling will help us to capture local details such as face, hands, and all those things. Our current formulation restricts scalability and development of user-controlled interfaces. Because one, scene-specific modeling makes it challenging to scale. We have to train a new model every time. Explicit modeling requires approximately 1 terabyte space to keep metadata to generate new views. This is a crucial aspect if we have to think about user-controlled interfaces. Third, we are doing a per-frame inference and does not encode temporal constraint. I hope the future work will explore representation that can encode arbitrary motion of both camera and objects. We now have a computational representation that can be estimated from observations. We move to exploring and creating audio-visual data. Let me quickly start with video exploration via example. And to motivate this direction, basically, there's a large body of work in this direction, but mostly restricted to supervised setup, showing a randomly sampled tiny subset here. Supervised approaches have led to great results, but the visual content is so diverse. Roughly 8.7 million known animal species and 400K known plant species. It is not possible to collect and annotate data for each, especially when we are talking about the visual and motion capture. We need unsupervised approaches. The current unsupervised approaches are primarily restricted to images with less user control. Example-based videos provide more control to a human user to express themselves. Let me show you an example. Let me show you John Oliver.
And no one in England having ever heard of you, no one really questions it. And it's kind of a life, I suppose.
Let me show you Stephen Colbert.
First group since the Beatles to earn 3 number one albums in less than a year.
Please welcome my close person.
If Stephen Colbert has to deliver John Oliver's content in his own style, in Stephen Colbert's own style, one would say it is the standard problem of facial translation that has been developed for the last 20 years. These approaches use supervised methods. In this work, we do not make use of any manual annotation and yet be able to do facial translation with just a video of John Oliver and Stephen Colbert. The left is the input John Oliver video and the right is the generated Stephen Colbert video. There's no cherry picking here. Let me play it for you.
But those stunts are just window dressing. What Amazon cares much, much more about, as they mentioned in their instructions 21 times, are incentives. And while few places are revealing what they offered, we do know that New Jersey reportedly offered $7 billion in tax breaks, which is an insane amount that other places may now have to compete with. And think about what that means. That could mean
now
billions
of tax
dollars.
Now, the crucial bit about this work is that it has nothing to do with facial videos. In fact, one can use a drastically different set of videos, like flowers. Now, the notion of content translation and style preservation is quite prevalent in flowers. When lily blooms in its own way. When rose blooms, it blooms in its own way, but they both bloom together. The content is blooming and the style is the way they bloom. This work got a lot of media attention, and I also got an opportunity to work with various production houses. You see, 2020 is not just the COVID year. It is also 75th anniversary of Second World War. Production houses such as BBC Studios want to make documentaries in first person instead of third person, telling the stories of Second World War. One example is the famous speech of Winston Churchill, "We will fight on the beaches, we will fight on the landing grounds," and so on. This speech was never visually recorded. Folks from BBC asked me if we can create a visual of this speech where Winston Churchill is seen speaking it. I said, sure, send me a short clip of Winston Churchill and an actor where Winston Churchill speaks of the same speech. When I said short, they literally sent me a 3-second video that was 180 cross 180 resolution. This is another example of Sparse real world sample. Here is a result. Now, this is not the best result, but this is the one that I'm allowed to show. And sorry, I cannot show the actor on the left over here. But let me play it.
We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender. And if, which I do not for a moment believe, this island or a large part of it were subjugated and starving, then our empire beyond the seas, armed and guarded by the British fleet, would carry on the struggle until, in God's good time, the new world with all its power and might steps forth to the rescue and the liberation of the old.
I have shown this project to you a couple of times. Let me now switch to the audio and rather discuss that in details, because I think the implications for audio are even more far-reaching than videos. We take voice for granted. But let me show you an example.
I was diagnosed.
Now, the woman in this video lost her voice. She used an electrolarynx, the device you see over here, to communicate. Can we do something to give her a natural voice, like her own previous voice or someone else's voice? Now, we have never heard this voice before. We have not heard this kind of voice before, and we want a certain voice in the output, and that's the only voice we have heard before. For example, Michelle Obama's voice here. Now, I claim that we can learn a simple autoencoder on only Michelle Obama's voice and be able to input anyone's voice at test time. Let me go back to my running example. We're gonna take electrolarynx as an input to our system, the one you heard before, and generate more natural voices. Now, To make a contrast, I will first play the sample from electrode earrings and then our approach to contrast two voices. Let me play it.
I was diagnosed at 37.
I don't show up, I
may the kids largest and abysmal.
They all were so hard to be too.
I started to feel tired. Then I thought I had swollen glands.
I have been collaborating with oncologists and physicians to take this forward for more clinical trials, but let me delve into the technical details for this project. First, let me show you the architecture of the model used here. We use an audio signal. The audio signal is converted to a MEL spectrogram using a short-time Fourier transform. The network architecture consists of three 1D con layers and bidirectional LSTMs that provides us with a latent code. The bottleneck of this latent code is crucial. Empirical observation shows that if we increase the dimensions, then it overfits. If we decrease, it fails to capture the voice. The decoder converts the latent code to MEL spectrogram. We use a WaveNet vocoder to convert it into an audio signal. We optimize using raw and generated audio signal and the two MEL spectrograms. In this work, we train autoencoder for one person, and that is why it is called as exemplar autoencoder. Let's learn a John Oliver autoencoder. Once trained, we can use anyone's voice. Now, inputting my advisor, Professor Deva Ramanan's voice, which was never heard before by this autoencoder, is the input.
Welcome to iClear 2021.
Welcome to iClear 2021.
Now, John Oliver speaks in English, but we can even input voice in a completely different language. Here is Kangal, who led this project as an undergrad summer intern last year and is now a PhD student here at CMU.
欢迎来到2021年国际学习表征会议。
The output.
欢迎来到2021年国际学习表征会议。
Finally, I can use my own voice in my own native language.
iClear 2021 में आपका स्वागत है।
iClear 2021 में आपका स्वागत है।
How is it that a simple autoencoder can generalize to unknown inputs? Let us first study the audio data itself. Given words spoken by 100 different speakers, we observe that MEL spectrograms for the same word cluster, even though they are said by different people. That is, similar words or phonemes cluster together in MEL space. We also study exemplar autoencoders. It is well known that linear autoencoders or principal component analysis, PCA, can project out of sample distribution onto manifolds spanned by training data. Shown here is a simple example where an out of sample point maps to training data subspace. We hypothesize that such a property may also be applicable or approximately applicable for a nonlinear autoencoder. Let me first get my spotlight marker over here. I'm getting my spotlight marker, just gonna wait for 1 minute. Now, given two speakers, SA and SB, we have learned an autoencoder for SA shown by the curve here. Given a word WB spoken by speaker SB, two things should happen if the hypothesis is correct. When we input WB to a trained autoencoder for speaker A, the transformed word WB to A should be in the space of A and not B. Second, the distance between WB and the corresponding word for SA, speaker A, should be much less than the average of distance between WB and other words for speaker A. Let's see if these properties hold. Once again, there are two speakers, A and B. The words of A are referred to as WA. The words of B are referred to as WB. WB to A refers to transformation of B to A. Now, given a couple of words spoken by speaker B shown on left, if I feed them to autoencoder A, will it sound like A or B? Will it be in subspace of A or will it be in subspace of B? We measure likelihood of B transformed to A. On the extreme right, higher value tells that they're more likely to be in subspace of A than B. The second question is, if the distance between WB and corresponding word for speaker A should be much lesser than the average of distance between WB and other words for SA. Now, the first column shows distance between transformed word and original word, just for reference. The second column shows minimum distance between words of speaker A and WB. The third column shows an average distance between words of speaker A and WB. We also show word corresponding to minimum distance. This also verifies that min distance corresponds to same word for speaker A. In summary, we observe both the properties hold. In conclusion, we observe that both audio data and exemplar autoencoder enable generalization to unknown inputs. Now, prior approaches have trained a fixed representation for learning audio transformation. The important prior art is AutoVC from Chian and colleagues. This work hypothesizes that speech consists of content and style. If we can get the required words for the target speaker and style of the target speaker, then we can compose the voice of target speaker for the given words. This approach utilizes a large VCTK dataset consisting of 109 speakers saying different sentences at training time. At test time, one can input any speaker. We use this approach with our speakers using the voice of Deva as input. Once again, Link.
This is the result of unsupervised audio-visual synthesis via exemplar autoencoders.
And style of John Oliver, a short speech segment, and pre-trained weights. Let me play the output. We get some gibberish audio. On the contrary, our approach.
This is the result of unsupervised audio-visual synthesis via exemplar autoencoders.
Now, let us also quantitatively evaluate our approach. We first use VCTK dataset for objective evaluation. This has been widely utilized in the past. There are three categories of work here. One, that are not zero shot and knows input at test time. Second, zero shot approaches such as AutoVC. Both of these categories use extra data for training. Finally, the third category is ours, that is zero shot, but does not use any extra data. Now, there are two criteria. One, does the resulting voice sound like a target speaker? We measured this using a speaker classification accuracy model, SCA shown over here. Higher is better. And two, do we preserve the content in the resulting speech? We measure using malceptral distance. These are standard criteria used by the audio community, shown by MCD over here. Lower is better. We observe competitive results to prior art without using any extra data. We now move from curated dataset to real-world scenarios and conduct human studies for evaluation. We introduce a dataset known as Celeb Audio that consists of 20 speakers whose data is downloaded from internet. Now, there are three versions of AutoVC here. One, using an off-the-shelf model trained on VCTK dataset. Number two, fine-tuning the model on Celeb Audio dataset. And number three, training an AutoVC model from scratch on Celeb Audio dataset without using VCTK as an initialization. We conducted human studies. We asked, one, how natural is this recording? We asked the human subjects to rate it on a scale from 1 to 5, where 1 is bad and 5 is excellent. We take an average of 10 human subjects for each sample shown as MOS or mean opinion score. We also compute preference for each approach by computing the mean opinion score for each sample. An approach for a higher MOS for a sample is considered preferable. So higher MOS and higher preference means better. Second question, how similar are the two voices? We follow the same procedure. And third question, we ask how similar are the two contents? And follow the same procedure. I want to mention that both voice similarity and content consistency cannot be measured in isolation. An approach may learn to generate similar voice for a random content, or an approach may learn to generate same content without voice translation. We therefore also measure a geometric mean of voice similarity and content consistency. Now, clearly from these analyses, we are very far from the excellent results on in the wild setup, but our approach enables better results than prior art. This analysis also highlights the need for evaluation on real world samples and to go beyond the curated data sets. Finally, we build a live demo using our system. Let me play it. I'm gonna record my voice.
This is a computer generated audio.
You can select you whosoever you want.
This is a computer generated audio.
Now, let me end this section with limitations and crucial challenges. One, as shown in the analysis as well, we are farther from the production quality results. Currently, to create content for entertainment applications, we need to do a lot of manual cleaning of the data before training the model. You may have also observed that I was speaking slowly when inputting the voice. We want to overcome these challenges. Secondly, we are currently using MEL spectrogram in our formulation. MEL spectrogram is a lossy transformation. Future work on learning directly on raw audio signals will hopefully avoid such lossy transformation. Number two, capturing prosody is extremely challenging for the target speaker. It is even more challenging for the use in assistive applications. And finally, we need to address crucial challenges in security and reliability posed by voice synthesis system. Audio fakes can be misused. Even more important, voice is used as password in many applications. My personal recommendation is to avoid using voice as password. You see, technology is a double-edged sword. While it has a potential for good in it, it can also be misused for spreading misinformation. Here is my old friend Rick Sebeck and on the left and young Rick Sebeck on the right. Old Rick Sebeck asked me if he could make his younger version say something, and I said, why not?
It's springtime in Australia. It's 1986. And already I know that in 35 or 40 years, it's going to be so easy to manipulate video that it will be wise not to believe anything you see or hear. Because really, I'm in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and it's the year 2019.
With great powers obviously comes great responsibilities. While videos from any source are not considered as an evidence in the court of law, they're still important in forming public opinion on social media like Twitter, Facebook, YouTube. Every time a viewer sees a generated content on these platforms, there needs to be a banner displaying this is a generated content so that they do not make any opinion out of it. I have been fortunate to work with ethicists, journalists, and philosophers to work on countering this issue, but we are still much far away. We have explored the representation that allows us, one, to observe continuous 4D visual world, and two, explore, analyze, and create new data using examples. I want to talk about one final thing about user controls. A user may not want a large number of keys, but giving some user control, for example, ability to explore and see the data could go a long way. In this thesis, I've also introduced ways for interactive exploration of visual data. Example, one can train exemplar autoencoders on frames of specific video. Remember our approach for training audio samples? We can use similar approach for the video samples as well. We call this approach video-specific autoencoders. Video-specific autoencoders enables a wide variety of video analytic tasks. Let me show a few of them. In our recent work, we observe a simple video-specific autoencoder trained on just the frames of the videos without any temporal information learns a continuous temporal space shown using the 2D projection of latent codes for an autoencoder trained for a flower video. It associates repetitive motion. You can see similar looking frames occur at same point in the PCA visualization. 0 and 70 has a similar position of the needle and they occur at the same point. And generate distinct modes in a video. Shown here is a video of a cheetah with two positions. We can also see average of two distinct modes. A simple operation on the latent codes of the trained autoencoder allows us to do temporal super resolution, that is, see temporal details even though it was not captured. For example, shown here are two frames of Obama video captured at two different time instants, T and T plus one. We can insert frames between them by simple interpolation of latent codes. We can apply to arbitrary videos and can create arbitrary large frame rate. Shown here is an original video captured at 30 frames per second. We can insert frames by interpolating latent code between two frames to create a 240 frames per second video. We did not optimize for temporal super resolution over here. Just by doing simple interpolation on the latent code, we can create like larger frame rate video. It also allows us to see the details in the video, showing 10x spatial super resolution over here. We use the reprojection property of the autoencoder that maps the low-res input shown on the left to the manifold of the training data and generates a high-res output. Remember the reprojection property I mentioned with exemplar autoencoder? The same holds here as well. Not only this, we can even quickly explore videos in a glance. For example, given an 11 minutes long video of Mr. Beans, we learn an autoencoder for this video. Once learned, the projected latent codes in a 2D space using PCA nicely separate the different modes in a video. We can see different modes for a video by looking at the average concept for each of these modes. We can even explore what each mode says. We can even zoom on each of the modes and subcluster them to see more details like a video tapestry. We can also create new videos from short length videos by associating two frames in a video and interpolating them. On the left is an original short video and the right is arbitrary long video. Let me play it. Now, importantly, we did not optimize for any of the tasks. The solution for them just emerged naturally by playing with latent codes and reprojection property of the autoencoders. Finally, let me also show you another aspect of user control, where a user can create images by using a simple paintbrush and a drag and drop tool. This type of user control can help a user to put their thoughts together and conceive the idea well. OpenShapes app is running on a single core CPU, enables 150 different backgrounds and object categories, take 10 seconds to generate 5 outputs for a label map without any system level optimization. I have thus far studied the three components independently. I look forward to bring both 4D observation and exploration together in a continual and streaming manner. Our user sees the 4D world, explore it, tell machine what to do. If there's something wrong, machine learns it, improves further, and then again go for observation. This is how we humans learn as well. In our recent work, we have shown the benefits of such streaming and continual learning. This paradigm shift would allow us to explore even more sparse and challenging setting. The presence of user would explicitly help in improving the quality of results. Eventually, this would bring us close to our goal of audio-visual communication, where we can communicate with one another and machines effectively. In the last 50 years, we have developed personal computers that can be used by anyone, anywhere as a means to access information. Here's an illustration of Alan Kay's vision by Glenn Keane. Shown here is a mother teaching her two daughters about an aquatic animal by just pointing the computer to it. This process of learning would not be easy if computers didn't exist, if cameras didn't exist, Wikipedia didn't exist, Google didn't exist. This access to information, which would have otherwise required days or weeks, is now on our fingertips. We have largely achieved this vision of computing, and we have universal access to the information. I believe the next two decades will enable us to develop personal computing for communication. Allow me to conclude with a scientific endeavor. The space of human imagination is much greater than the space or our abilities to physically capture our world. We humans have amazing mental powers to reconstruct or imagine the scenarios from sparse signals or tiny bits of information. The fundamental question is, how can machines densely reconstruct and generalize from sparse signals? We are currently in the early days of this research, and I believe the next decade of research will bring more diverse ideas to solve this problem. I have been fortunate to work with so many wonderful people in the last few years, including people in academia, production houses, artists, performance captures, journalists. Unfortunately, I could not list them all in one slide. I thank you all for shaping my thoughts and making me a better human being. I would also acknowledge the support from various organizations for financial support and media houses to frequently cover my work. With personal computers for communication, the world will be our personal studios. Happy to take any questions. Thank you.